Basically, what I do from time to time is give people some insight on how things work. So this is not going to be about .NET at all. It's about another pattern, and you can see Twisted Event Machine Node, so those of you who use that on a day-to-day basis can understand what's going to happen now. But usually I've discovered that people use those things, but they don't know how they work underneath, and that causes a lot of small things. So, as Fernand was saying, I do a lot of things around non-Microsoft technologies. I'm working either on the products by themselves. That could be Debian, that could be Symfony, that could be Drupal, a lot of things. And I'm a contributor and I'm a maintainer. I do a lot of things there. Or it could be around what you do, and I help a lot of startups getting their things to run correctly when you need to scale a bit. So, most of my work is around getting an application that has the potential to win something. So basically, you have to solve the business problem, you have to solve the UI problem, you have to solve a lot of things. But when it begins to work, when you get some traction, you're faced with a new issue, and that issue is called users. And basically, that kills you, because as soon as you begin to get some traction, your app just goes down and you're hosed. So that's not something unusual. I've done a lot of Facebook applications, for example. When a Facebook app begins to, well, get users, it gets users like 20 more thousand users every 3 hours during a day. So it means that you won't have time to react. And that would be an entire other talk. So now what I want to try to understand is how we solve that issue. So when you have too many things to do and very little time, how do you solve that issue? So there are solutions for humans, and that one is quite efficient. You basically delegate and put all the same tasks in one bucket and do that from time to time. And that's the exact opposite of multitasking, and it's the most efficient way for a human to do many different things. So, and you should try that, basically avoid some email. Well, that's another talk, so I'll just go on to machines. So if I'm that kind of thing, and I need to handle requests coming in, and I have a lot of them coming in, where do I get blocked? So the easy part is on the left. You've got a lot of threads that are pushing information to you. I don't want to talk about that part. It's, well, you have a host of solutions out there to divert the requests, put them in other places, use Nginx, serve static content, cache, whatever. I don't care. Next, you're going to run some useful code for your users, and that's going to happen on the machine by itself, on the server, and you're trying to manage as many tasks as possible, so you queue useful things to do, you add cores to do them, and of course, you call in two external resources to, well, get an information to a given user, add something to something else, and so on. Now, what you see when you begin to handle the load is adding more CPU does not help at all. Because basically, what happens is most of the time, you are waiting for other things to happen. You are waiting for the network to answer, you are waiting for the disk to answer, you're waiting for a lot of things to happen. And that's not taking any CPU. So what happens is each task running there takes some time. So the queue of impending tasks starts to grow. So that queue explodes because it takes time to do nothing useful from a CPU perspective. And you can get bigger servers, it won't solve your problem. So how do you handle that? Well, you don't have to. That's an old problem in computing, and basically every operating system knows exactly how to deal with that. When you think of it, when you launch your computer, open a dozen applications, 100 tabs, and so on, it's a bit slow, of course, because of network, because of a lot of things, but the file system in itself is not the biggest issue. And those who have SSDs know exactly what I mean. You have a measurable gain, but it's not all instant. And what happens is the kernel knows how to handle many, many files at a given point in time. So they have a way to say to the application, call me, give me something to do, like open a file and read the content, and forget about me. I'll warn you when I have the information. And in that way, you are not multitasking. Basically, you are not doing several hundred tasks in parallel. You are initiating several hundred tasks, and then you stop doing, and you're just waiting for tasks to come back and say, I'm ready. So how does that translate technically? Every operating system out there has a solution. So it's called EPOL, CAQ, IOCP, completion port in Windows. And you don't have to know about that part. It works. It uses approximately the same techniques on every operating system. And you have abstractions layers on top of that so that you don't have to care about how it's really done. It doesn't do everything. It usually does files and network I/O, which are the two most common tasks, because network means database and files means files. Now, when you want to use those, and I go back to my web application, I'm going to try to run in that mode, saying basically, I had three distinct things to do and they had wait I/O wait times in there. I had to read some things, I had to wait for network answers. So I don't do that sequentially. I don't do that in a multi-threaded mode because threads consume a lot of resources and switching from a thread to the next one is useless work. By the way, do you know how what's the ideal number of processes on an 8-core machines and the ideal number of threads? It's 8. One CPU, if it does only one thread, is at its maximum performance. So what we want to do is a way to stack all those operations on a single thread, taken from the Java world, so big design. That's the kind of explanations, so we call that a loop, and it doesn't say anything. So how does it work underneath? And it's pretty simple. All you have to do is, when you have a task that you can push to the operating system, you send the tasks away. Then the operating system has a way to call you, and then you wait for the callback. So it's a loop. And you have the Ruby event machine loop in there, saying basically, I'm waiting for answers from the timers and answers from the, in that case, network I/O. So this code does exist in event machine. You don't see it, but you run that code. And that's the important part, because basically, people always say it's async, it's parallel, it's a lot of things. That's not asynchronous at all. That's a plain, simple loop running on a plain, single thread. So there's no magic in there. And it means that when you are coding against those frameworks, you must know that you have a loop behind you, and that loop has one thread. Be it node, be it twisted, be it event machine, you still get one thread. So if you have some useful things to do in CPU terms, you must do those outside of that thread, because that thread has a single purpose, which is getting information back from the operating system and calling your code. In event machine, you have low-level instructions that help you to go to the main thread, the event loop thread, or to go to a thread pool, so do some work on another thread. You have exactly the same in Python. You don't have that by default in Node, because Node is single-threaded by design. You can find some funny things. So that's my .NET moment of the evening. And you'll find that Edge project that allows you to use another stack to run threads outside of the main Node thread. So in that case, you can put a .NET expression and use the .NET thread pool if you need it. There are other solutions, but being Microsoft, of course, I would choose that one. Now, that seems quite efficient. That seems the solution to everything. And basically, I've told you once or twice that you had a loop with a single thread on it. So if you block that loop, you're not going called back by the operating system because you're not here to listen, or you are piling things again and you're getting out of sync. So basically, you're going to break everything, and it's non-predictable. You can't understand what's happening because you can't reproduce that. When you run that on your box, it just works. When you run in production, it randomly misses some notification from the OS. So it's very hard to diagnose. You might think that not blocking that loop is easy, but there are two problems. The first one is your code. Your code is into that loop by default, so you must escape from that loop and have your code run elsewhere. And you use a lot of modules that are given by some gems, given by some packages, given by a lot of things. Those modules must be careful as well. And let me give you a small sample. So that's from Node.js and that console.log, which might be useful. It's just a way to extract some information and push that so that you can understand how things are running. Guess what? This is synchronous, meaning it blocks the loop while it runs. So I discovered that when working on a big project, and we had 8 servers in production, and we hit a real peak, and things began to scramble. We were losing some packets, we were losing some images, we were serving 750 million images, and we were losing some of them, and we didn't know what happened. The developers just went to the code and put more console.log to understand what was happening. The servers stopped. So if Node.js, core Node.js, is able to do those kind of things, that must mean something. And if you go to Ruby, for example, an event machine, and you go a bit in more detail, you will discover that there are a lot of things on top of the event loop, so you don't see it, and some gems do handle correctly those kind of things, a lot of them just don't. So the main problem with those systems is they depend on your code, and your code is going to do stupid things. So that dependency kills those systems. You must be highly skilled to use correctly Node, Event Machine, or Twisted in production. It just doesn't work. Every single mistake goes back to the whole chain. So there's another way to do it, but I don't have the time to do it fully. And the idea is, we're not using that loop the way we used to. So basically, that loop used to call directly my code and on the same thread, basically. What I want is to put a level of indirection there. I want to say, when you're about to do something, don't do it. Push that on a queue, push that as a message somewhere, and something else, someone else, will take that call and we'll do something with it, and we'll push back the result to you. So that pattern, funny enough, is implemented by the Open Telecom platform in Erlang. That one of the main implementation is Erlang for those kind of things, because Erlang is geared at multiprocesses and communication between a lot of processes and handling the fault, the failures, and so on. So basically, if something breaks, it breaks, and it's not an issue for you. You have a good solution in Ruby, which is called Celluloid, done by Tony Arcieri, which is, it's a lot of things, it's just not Celluloid, so have a look at it, and you'll discover things that are much more robust than what you have in those systems. So, as a conclusion, this is not something that you must fear from day one, because when you don't have load, it won't be there. So when you are just playing around MVP, well, you just don't care. If you need to have one server per user, that's not an issue when you are designing your application just to show it to someone and to get some feedback. So that's in my initial... So basically, is it useless? Don't go to that level right now. So take the time to do things in a quick and dirty way initially, and know that when you got your ID, when your MVP is something that you can describe in a few words. Now it's time to get rid of that code because it will bite you back severely and quickly. So just know that it's not for day one, but maybe after the first month, it's time to find a technical founder and spend some time on how that's going to scale after. And that's all.